Good morning. Actually, it's good afternoon, everybody. And we're going to actually go ahead and take a look at another Beethoven sonata. The one we'll be looking at today is Opus 31, number 3. This is a very popular sonata with a lot of auditions and pianists. The whole Opus 31 set actually is a very popular set. I've heard it numerous times, played by lots of people when I was at the conservatory. Lots of music schools play. Lots of pianists play this piece. It's a middle of the road sonata. It's not too difficult of a piece of music, but it's not the easiest either. But it's a very well put together piece of music. Let's just put it that way. It's a good meaty piece. It's nice. Nice piece. And this is the third one, obviously, in the set. And Beethoven published this around 1802, somewhere around that. And he published this as a set of three sonatas. He has he has the 16th, which is in G major. It's a very lively, very humorous piece of music. We have the Tempest Sonata, which is number 2 in D minor, the only sonata by Beethoven written in D minor. It's a rather more of a tragic piece of music, I would say. It definitely has darker, more dramatic undertones to it. And then you've got this sonata, which is a little, it's much more lyrical. I would call it more organic. It's not tragic. Certainly it's not tragic. It's not too dramatic, I would say. But it's much more playful, I would say. I think it's a very playful sonata. And this piece, I'm going to be referring to quite... actually, a couple of sources this time that I haven't done before. And this is the Charles Rosen paper, his article on his thoughts on Beethoven sonatas and how he breaks apart some elements, he breaks apart some ideas. And I've also done my homework using the book on Donald Francis Tovey, his analysis of the Beethoven sonatas as well. So I'm going to be referring to these two sources from time to time, as well as my own viewpoint of the sonata. So that's this piece in a nutshell. So 1802-ish is when this piece was written. The D minor sonata was definitely the most revolutionary piece in this set. When Beethoven spoke about trying to find new ways of composing, he was referring mostly not to this sonata, but most likely to the previous sonata, number 2, The Tempest, which you can also follow. I did a lecture on this, analysis on this, quite a while back. So let me get a drink of water. So we've got quite a lot of material, so let's go ahead and dive into it. So it's an E-flat major, as we can see by the key signature, but it does not start in E-flat major. It starts rather very ambiguous. And the introduction, I feel, has the ambiguity of the previous sonata, the Tempest sonata. The opening of the Tempest was in the wrong key. It started on a 5-6 chord of the tonic, and it had multiple tempo markings. And this one kind of has the same undertone, I guess you could say, for this. Is it doesn't really start on the tonic, rather. It starts not really even on the dominant. This is actually a 4. This is an A-flat, so... And A-flat adds 6 chord, so... It's a very colorful chord. And he begins with this little motif right here. And he's going to be using this, not surprisingly, constantly throughout the rest of the sonata, at least this first movement. So he begins this little really lovingly. It's a very nice, it's not dramatic really, it's kind of melancholy almost. And he has this descent down to the bass. He starts in the middle. Now, we've seen, I've spoken about this before, when you're starting a piece of music or a new phrase, you should keep in mind that you need to take it somewhere. So, for example, if you start in the middle at forte, that doesn't really give you very much room to grow. You need to do something. You need to keep that in mind. You can't really grow too much. You could grow to maybe a fortissimo, but you can't grow dynamically. You can only diminish it, and you can't. And if you start at the very top and bottom, for example, that's extreme. That allows you to come forward. But Beethoven decides he's going to start in the middle, and his way of growing is using a little bit of the registers here, not too much. I mean, we see that he is jumping down these registers a little bit, but here, for example, this whole phrase is essentially in one position, essentially in the, I would call it the alto range, very singable register for it, and only then does he, right here, repeat himself up in the soprano range right up here, and same with the left hand. So, but he has a crescendo here. He builds up to this moment, and what's really pushing this forward is the rhythm, the rhythmic characteristic of these first couple of bars, as well as the harmonic content. Now, this is what's really interesting. That is, I should really point out, is, let me change a color. So he starts here, but he rises up chromatically. So see, this F goes up to a G sharp right up here. And this may have been a mistake by Beethoven, writing a G flat instead of an F sharp. As Tovey points out a little bit, I don't think it makes too much of a difference, but nevertheless, it is what it is. I'm going to adjust something. There we go. There we go. So I don't think it's the biggest issue in the world, honestly, but he decides for one reason or the other to write a G flat, where it could have been F sharp. But that's just a really insignificant detail. And he's working his way up to this 6-4 chord, 1-6-4, right here, where we can finally resolve on a 5. We kind of have a 7th hidden in there, and then to a 1. And this right here is really the first moment when we establish tonality. We finally know, aha, we are in E-flat. We are in E-flat major. And then he repeats this phrase, and he doesn't repeat the same thing twice. That's something that Beethoven is very good at. He doesn't repeat himself. He has this very characteristic of him, and also of previous composers, such as Mozart and Haydn, of having this combination of diatonic and chromatic scalular run. And then he comes down here again. Bum ba dum bum ba dum bum 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 bum. Scrolling down a little bit. Jung 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 jung. He's using again these registers. Has a nice little appoggiatura right here with a grace note. And again, 6-4, or no, that's not a 6-4. What is that? Da 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 dum. That's our 6-4. And then right here we start to, the music really starts to move forward. So with all that little bit of an introduction, let's go ahead and listen to it. This is going to be a MIDI playback to prevent copyright stuff, which on my last video didn't really go too well. It's had to dispute that too, even though it was not a performance. So I don't know what we're going to do about that. So anyway, so here we go. Here is the exposition of the first movement. Here we go. That's the exposition. Lots of material that we will need to dig through a little bit. So let's start back up here. So, and looking at my notes to make sure I don't miss anything. So we are, where are we? So we've established, so he's got two phrases going on right here. So I need to choose a different color. Let's do green. So we've got this green line is representing one phrase. This is trend. I'm gonna call it transition, but he's actually gonna reuse this material. He recycles everything. He's very economical in his use of music. I mean, he's so good at it. Here's the second phrase. Yeah, I'm not going to talk about phrase structure. That's something that you can learn at conservatory and whatnot, sentences versus periods and stuff like that. So anyway, so you notice that there's a little bit of a difference between the two phrases. I mean, obviously for reasons, I mean, the voicing's a little bit different and the register is certainly different as well. And using the registers of your instrument is definitely a big thing that we should be conscientious of as composers. And it adds more, it's like the gradient of different colors. If you're a painter, you have your primary colors. I mean, here's a great example. I mean, you've got all these different colors, right? So if you're a painter, I mean, your main colors, red, blue, green. That's what the human eye can see, right? Red RGB. That's why your monitor is made up of red, blue, and green pixels. You can make every single color with these colors by mixing them. And you can, so a blue is not just a blue, so you can think of maybe a register as the gradation of a certain color. I mean, I'm not synesthetic. I don't have synesthesia, but I imagine that Beethoven was thinking in terms of, you know, what kind of colors he's looking for. Maybe perhaps also instrumentation, orchestration. What kind of instruments do I hear? instead of maybe a piano, maybe I hear a flute up here and then an oboe. Actually, I hear a clarinet right here. And then the strings, for example, come in here. So why is this important? This is important because it allows you to interpret the music and see it in a completely different, more retrospective way. It allows you to understand, perhaps, the music a lot more than just looking at this as a piano piece. And especially when it comes to Beethoven, he's very obviously an orchestrator. In his other sonatas and all types of his writing, I mean, sometimes he's imagining a string quartet, and he's writing tons of music at the same time, so this isn't completely out of left field, but it's good, especially as a pianist and even as a composer. I mean, this is helpful to try to voice these. Imagine it's like, okay, I hear this as maybe string sections or as trombones, like down here, for example, resolving. And maybe here's some strings with winds. I mean, this helps you really grasp and allow you to perform the music the way that you want to. I mean, this is not all the same. I mean, there's definitely pianistic effects, but, you know, you get the idea. So, and as a composer, this is helpful to allow your music to grow, to expand, to not get you stuck in a hole, to allow you to, yeah, imagine, don't just imagine the sound of the piano, imagine the sound of an orchestra, what kind of instruments you have, what kind of sound, what kind of timbres you have at your disposal, and try to replicate those. So, and it just creates a much more open-ended type of music. So he's got this run going up here, repeats himself, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, in the same register. And let's see, do I have it? Yes. So now we're in one, and the music really starts to get moving. And here's another phrase. Now this is new right here, this little gunk, gunk, this is a little variation, and he's going to be reusing this later. Again, using the registers. This pedal point is a nice way of establishing movement and also remaining grounded on the tonic as well. So this is a nice, useful, simple thing. And this is also a practical thing because he also wants these voices. You see them chromatically, well, not chromatically, but descending down. And you even see it in the fingerings. This is just incredibly practical. He wanted I mean, you're following octaves right here. You definitely want an octave here. You don't want to, it'd sound very, very dry if he left out this bottom E. He could have, though. Let me get an eraser. And you're going to hear planes coming overhead. I'm by an airport, so he could have omitted this E right up here, but he actually really could have omitted this. I'm trying to figure out why he hasn't. I think it would have, may have weakened it a little bit, but these are just tiny things. The reason I'm wondering about that is just looking at the voicing. He's got two. He's doubling the the tonic. So yeah, he might be doing that. Well, he's tripling it actually. I don't know. Yeah, maybe he's just trying to be consistent. But you see the fingering 1-1-1. So you're playing this with your thumb, and then you're going to be transitioning over to 4 and 5. So you're moving your hand to a new position. So this is a practical thing, and this is something that, I mean, when I'm looking at student compositions for piano, I mean, they don't have any clue how to write for the piano. They say, "Oh, I can play it," They don't have any concept of "Hey, have you played this?" I mean, it's just so awkward, and it's again, I'm not going to go much further into that, but this is something he was aware of. I mean, you're imagining playing this, and you're also imagining the orchestration and the compositional elements, and there's so much that you have to juggle together to really create something wonderful. So he's in piano, and he's simply just repeating this phrase, and this is a little variation. Dun-dun-dun. Instead of this dotted rhythm, he has a trill with a suffix resolving down. Same thing here. So here's another phrase. And then remember this. That is that. Very loosely. And then he develops this little... I mean, gosh, he's just recycling everything. Everything is connected to everything else. This little... And right here... Nope, we're still in the first theme. If we're in sonata form, this is... We're in theme one. This is not an introduction. We're in theme one. Where does he start transitioning? Right here. There you go. So the reason so we know this is transition material. When we start seeing accidentals, consistent accidentals, he starts modulating. And he's really sequencing, he's really elongating this passage, these quote, eighth note passages, having these nice slurs, crescendo. I mean, very careful with his dynamics. He hasn't gotten loud yet. In minor now, so this is still transition material, and he's still using the same phrase right here. But now he's taking apart this dum bum 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 bum. And now he's sequencing. And he didn't have any suspensions before. I can easily hear dun 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 bum. Be a really awkward suspension, but he could have done it here. But the suspension just adds a nice little touch, and he's modulating through keys that I didn't write down and I don't feel like analyzing right now, but you can do that on your own. But he's using the registers again. I mean, look at what he's doing, and also look at this nice, beautiful contrary motion in the top and bottom voices. This is just classic Bach four-part writing. And bum, 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 bum. So like that rising... bum, 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 bum. So this note is... You throw it up a half step. So... I mean, everything is tied together. Nothing is accidental here. Goes up the register, has nice contrast, comes back down. And what this does is it creates a call and response element to it. It's like, imagine, I mean, I'm hearing, this is the woodwinds, this is a perfect register for winds. Perhaps, actually now I'm thinking about it, I hear flutes up here. Maybe brass instruments or strings. So, I mean, he's orchestrating this. I mean, it's wonderful. And then he just takes this little fragment, jump, bump. Jump, bump, 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 bum. And now he's established. Aha, we are in the five. We are in five of five, and now we can come to... Oh, I'm sorry, what are we in? Yeah, yes, we are in 5 of 5. 5 of 5. And here is theme 2. Without really any preparation, he just jumps right into it. Just arrest and then bam, theme 2. And is theme 2 contrasting? So, theme 2 is very lyrical, and this is... a bit of a foreshadow of the third movement, where the third movement of this sonata is very lyrical. So, this little, this is halfway through the phrase right here. But he keeps over this little figuration, this we just heard this too. This little part. So he's making a purpose of everything. So he's breaking apart this three stroke, 1, 2, 3, bum, 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 bum. Fourth symphony motive, or fifth symphony motive rather. These four notes right here. Junk, 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 bum, 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 bum. And he's just, he varied it, and now he's recycling it again. Bum, 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 bum. So, and this is just simple Alberti bass, making sure that he's balancing his chords by changing certain notes around and inversions and stuff. Again, you can do that on your own. But, here's the answer to the phrase, the end of the phrase right here. And he's got this little cadenza after this. And this cadenza is not virtuosic at all. It's not marked forte. I think it's marked piano, actually. Yeah, it's marked piano right there. And it's kind of a... It's fun. At least that's what I interpret it as. It's him having fun, I think, because he comes right back to the same thing again. He hasn't modulated at all. The only thing he's changing now, he's not changing the bass either. He's just changing the right hand, and he's just adding, he's developing this little figuration right here from right here. And he's also making it obvious by writing in these little slurs, these double slurs. So, it's funny. There's the end of that phrase. And then we're going to go right up to here, a little bit of syncopation, just to vary it up a little bit. Now we've got a new theme right here. We haven't heard this before. And on my analysis, I am hesitant to call it, you could call it theme 3, I suppose. It's in the same key. And it's just a scalar passage with this trill. Now this trill, where have we heard this before? We have heard it. Where is it? Here it is right here. This little passage right here. So he's bringing this back. So it's not foreign. This doesn't sound foreign to us. It sounds like it's naturally cohesive. And he's just breaking it down. And he needs to get back to the dominant. So he has this little... He doesn't really modulate, but he walks around chromatically, harmonically, and ooh, fancy. So he's just breaking all this down right here. Fragmentation and then sequencing that little fragment. He's got this little run again right here, which we're going to see he recycles as well later. We're on the 5. This little part, little passage. from this little passage right here. So rhythmically, very similar. So I mean, it's just, isn't this incredible? I mean, he was not accidental about any of this. Got a nice little trill right here, and this acts as a pedal. This trill right here. While we have what we just heard before, this little eighth note passage bouncing around up. Just, these are just basic triads too, arpeggios. Bum 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 ba da da dum bum bum bum. This closing theme. At least I would put it there. And then this is basically just stripping the entire phrase down from the very first bar. No dotted rhythms, because here it is. Bum bum dum bum. Almost an augmentation of the theme. Bum bum ba da 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 bum ba da 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 dum. And then he's gotta repeat back to the beginning. So, and then here's our three strokes. You can see them right here. Yeah, so, I mean, geez, so economical. He's always like this. Beethoven's always like this. He is so consistent. And yeah. So he has established now all the tools, all the things he's going to be utilizing in the development. And it's going to be hopefully pretty obvious what he's going to be doing with them. So let's go ahead and with all that in mind, let's go ahead and re-listen to the exposition and listen to the development section, and then we'll go ahead and talk about the development section. So let's go ahead and back it up and play it again. Thank you. So that was the development section, and you could hear how he connects everything together in this piece. So let's go ahead and talk about the development section. He begins very matter-of-factly, if that's a word. And the reason, the way he does it is he simply just repeats the, he leaves you hanging. It's kind of unimaginative, but I mean, it opens the door though for him to actually develop something instead of just jumping right in. So he says, okay, here's the theme again. Get ready to be prepared for something to happen. This is developing an expectation. Da da dum ba da dum bum bum bum. And this voicing is different. All of this right here is different from the beginning. This is a deeper voicing. It's lower. It's thicker. And actually, my Henley edition gives me a little note right here. A little note that says, in the original edition and many early impressions, sometimes the C is missing in this bar. Sometimes the contra A flat is missing as well. And in this is the Dover edition, I believe. And, looks to me it's the same. But also in the first edition, though, he is right, the Henley edition is, that this A-flat is actually omitted down here. Why? I have no idea. I don't believe we have the manuscript to this, but I would play it exactly as it's written, it looks like, right here. I mean, no one... Unless you have a really bad piano, I don't see why you shouldn't. So he begins right here. And he has a retardando right above it, so just like the beginning. And he's crescendoing. He does not end on a fermata right here. You're still slowing down, and... this is actually, at this point, this is C minor, which is actually technically a deceptive cadence right here. And this is new. This is very shocking. It's different. We've heard this many times before, I think three times now. And to hear this is a little bit striking. And then even to hear... an F sharp minor? Looks like an F sharp minor chord right here. Maybe it's diminished. Okay. No, it's an F sharp minor. Okay. No, it's diminished. There's the E flat right there. So, anyway, so now the real development starts happening. We've heard this before. In the beginning, however, he then starts to fragment it and build down. And he's building down to bring this section back. He's playing with this, and this is why I was questioning earlier about why he didn't just have an E flat on the... Let me show you real quick. Right here, why he didn't... Yeah. So he's a little, this is just a minor, just almost a nothing mention of something, but he could have omitted, again, this E flat right up here, this tenor E flat, and just kept the bass E flat, and it would have been fine, and he could have likewise have, where are we? He could have put a C right here, but he decides not to for whatever reason, so... So cool, we are in C major now. And he's going to be bouncing around through the keys. He's going to be going into some pretty foreign keys, but not too foreign. I mean, this isn't the 20th century, but he's going to be walking through a circle of fifths, and he's keeping this pedal tone throughout. Very similar to the first phrase or the second phrase. And now he's switching hands right here. This is where things for me get interesting is this figure, this very light, very delicate and fragile figuration, he's now putting down in the bass, which becomes naturally very heavy for a piano and for a pianist to play, because it's not an octave to play, so it can be a little awkward to play. And it would have actually, I was thinking about reversing these two notes around instead of this B flat or this B natural being played. I was thinking just switching these two notes around, you know, instead it's ba-dum, ba-dum, instead of ba-dum, ba-dum. But I think he made the right decision here. It's got a lot of character to it. On top of that, you have this nice little clashing, it's a little tiny little suspension really right here. And then making sure not to neglect the upper register, because we are in the bass register right now, and that's the main focus. But this little figuration comes back, so this is a nice little hand crossing right here. Ba-dum, 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 ba-dum. And then this measure right here is interesting. This might look like new material, but it's not. I think it derives a little bit from this passage right here, it might be a little far-fetched, but this is basically just an arpeggio, essentially. He's breaking it up, and that's essentially what he does right here, so. Where are we? Yeah. Did I skip something? There it is. So I think that's what I think he's doing, because it is very, very similar. He's got the same little da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- this right here, right there, and he uses this as counter, and then, oh god, this is great. He uses this as counterpoint right here. Where does this come from? We've seen this before, right here. And I mean, it's not complex. This isn't really too hard to write, so to speak. I mean, this is just an arpeggio, but it's very simple. And my rule, not my rule, but a rule of thumb, a good thing to keep in mind is keep things simple. Keep your initial ideas simple in music so they can become more complex. They can develop to be complex and intricate later in the piece of music. If you start complex, it really gives you very little room to develop. So this is why a lot of Bach's fugues, for example, his subjects are, well, most of them are pretty simple, but he knows he's going to be writing a four-voice fugue, so, I mean, the rest of the four voices are going to take care of themselves. It's going to be pretty intricate enough. So I see a lot of composers trying to write these really complex, like today, several students are trying to write really complex music right off the bat, and I think it's a mistake to do that because it makes it very difficult for you to bring out your good ideas. But keep things simple. It might sound really baby simple to you, but in the context of maybe some other voices interlacing with this very simple idea, it becomes very rich and full of life. So hope that's a little piece, and I won't stop harping about that. I think it's a very good piece of advice. So he modulates a little bit around here. He has this again. So he's just, I mean, it's pretty obvious, I think. He's just cutting and pasting. This is all the same thing. He just modulates. So he's got this nice little what key is he in, actually? He's an F. I'm not going to go through every single key, but there you go. This is actually an interesting moment right here, where he sets up a false sense of where you're expecting to go. So he's got an F7, basically a five of 5 of B flat. And we're expecting B flat major. But we don't get that. We get B flat minor instead, which is actually pretty shocking to hear. It's actually a really interesting moment in the piece. And he starts sequencing this again. Now here's something that's really interesting right here, is how is he going to bring back the recapitulation? How is he going to come back to the recapitulation? Because that happens right here. The recapitulation is right there. Now, Beethoven is really good at this. And this is also something that, if you excuse me, I'm going to reference the article by Charles Rosen that I highlighted this section. Where he comes back to the recapitulation. This is something I didn't know. Was Haydn, of his thousands and thousands of pieces of music, he smuggles his way back into recapitulations like this. Let me just read the quote. "The principle is a simple one, grandly exploited for many decades by Haydn. Repeat a single detail insistently over and over again, and listeners will be persuaded that what follows was inevitable as long as there is some reasonable continuity." So that's essentially what he's referring to, Charles Rosen, in his article on this sonata. And this is what you can see that Beethoven is doing this. And we've had staccatos before, so very short with trills and whatnot. And now legato. It's all these slurs, and it's very contrasting. And he repeats this. And then you just boink. Oh, we're back. So that's what Rosen is referring to, where you insistently play a single detail over and over and over again, this little motive. And it becomes, we get used to it, we accept it, and we're like, okay, yeah, this feels right, yep, I understand this, and then, oh, here we are, huh, it just morphs into the recapitulation, and this is absolutely wonderful. It's key that Beethoven, this isn't the only time that Beethoven's done this, he's done it on numerous other sonatas, where he's just walked right into the recapitulation, and you just didn't even know that the recapitulation hit you. So, very wonderful writing. Recapitulation is pretty normal, same as reexposition, more or less. I'm not gonna go into too much of it, and I might play it, just play really quickly through it. But couple key differences: this little cadenza gets extended out a little bit further, actually quite a lot further. This is all the same thing. Bum ba dum bum. Now here's the coda. Let's talk about the coda. Well, let's actually hear the coda first, and then we can start talking about it. We're going to pick up on the coda. Oh, I lost my place. Okay, so let's listen a little bit to the development section again, with all that in mind, or actually the recapitulation. Let's listen to the recapitulation. And let's hear how he comes back into here. Let's hear how he gets to the recapitulation, the things he's changed, and then how he closes up the piece with the coda. So let me see if I can get to that spot. I lost my place, so... Let's develop it. right, so the coda is pretty self-explanatory, but let's go ahead and talk about it anyway. So the coda begins on 4, which is actually kind of weird. So he needs to somehow get back to 1, and he does, thankfully. He's very aware of that. So he begins the same way and as the exposition, and I mean, it's pretty similar. Da, 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 bum, ba, dum. This is here's where things are changing a little bit. Ba, dum, ba, dum. He's basically just taking this little section and then just inserting it right here. This little resolution. And he's just switching around the octaves. He's using it to modulate. And then we're finally home right here. And this has changed. Now, he used a combination of diatonic and chromatic notes to work his way up this little scalular run. And now he's just using chromatic to get his way up here. Same. Here's really where it starts to feel like we're coming to a conclusion. It's a little funny little run. And then he writes a little two-part canon right here. Sort of, kind of. And he uses this. Yeah, so. Not really a canon, but it feels kind of like a canon, though. It's got entry, another entry down here. So, it ends off with all those eighth notes. Same. So, very humbling way to end it, I think. Ends off with a bang, but he doesn't build there. He makes it quiet and then just slaps us in the face with boink boink. So he kind of leaves us hanging, like it's gonna end. It's gonna end soon. He doesn't, you know, the listener's like, you know, when's he gonna end it? And then boink boink. I mean, he could have gone on more. He could have gone on for as long as he wanted to. And I've just done this. So there you go. There's that sonata in a nutshell, that first movement. My favorite movement, my second favorite, I think, actually, is this one, the scherzo. This is a very fun piece, I think. It's very humorous. Lively, as Beethoven instructed, with vivace. And it's funny. I think it's humorous and quirky, so to speak. And it keeps that same character, that friendly character that we had in the first movement over. So we're in A-flat major. So let's hear the exposition of this real quick. So I'm going to have to speed up the tempo from Ableton, so let me see if I can get it to here. Boy, it's at 20. Seems like a good tempo. Okay, so let's listen to the exposition and we'll talk about it afterwards. Thank you. interesting thing that we're going to figure out here later down the road, but I'm going to show you. I think you might be really intrigued. But so it's a chorale. He begins this very chorale-like chords. Da 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 da. So you can see this phrase. Let's choose a different color. That works, I guess. Da. So here's the big phrase. Jump. So let's see if I get my notes out. So this movement is a scherzo, and it's taking the place of a slow movement. So traditionally in a classical sonata, if you're writing a sonata, the second movement is conventionally considered the slow movement. You can also have a scherzo, which is what Beethoven does in this case. He writes a scherzo in place of the slow movement. This entire sonata actually does not have a slow movement. The third movement is a minuet, and the fourth one is marked presto con fuoco, with fire. So very fast with fire is not exactly slow. So, and allegretto is not considered slow. It's not really considered quick. Many have argued that quarter note equals 76 thereabouts is about as fast as allegretto. So it's moderate, but it's, we're not going to go into a debate on that. But one thing that really strikes me is this bass line, this bouncy bass line. It's very creative, I think. And this is where I believe the orchestration, at least in Beethoven's head, the orchestra comes into play, because this, I imagine maybe a tuba, maybe an oompa, tuba, or a bassoon, or maybe a little bit of both. But I don't associate this with maybe not a string instrument, but definitely like a wind or a brass instrument that can reach down there. So a bassoon, I think, would be more appropriate an association, because in Beethoven's time, his pianos, this register, wasn't very punchy. It sounded more like a bassoon. It had a very reedy sound timbre to it. So what else? This bass line also adds perpetual motion. It adds not really motor rhythm, but it has that sense of movement, and it keeps on moving forward. And if this was absent, this chorale would be very stale and static. Jum bum bum ba da dum bum 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 ba 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 bum. So, excuse me. So this bass line is very clever, I think, because the line itself above it, the soprano line, is the chorale is. It's not too interesting, I don't think, but what really makes it stand out is this bass line. This bass line in the left hand, I mean, it's very funny. It's very quirky, and it just, it's humorous. It's humorous. So he uses this a lot. Let's see, where am I at? So the eighth notes are constantly running, and when they're not, he uses this new theme, this new motive, I guess. We can call it, we can do it this way. We're going to call, let's see if I can scroll up here, this whole chorale, we're going to call A. And this little section here, we're going to call B. That includes this trill and whatnot. And the playback missed, I guess the MIDI file left this out. But, bum, bum, ba-dum, bum, bum, ba-la-la-lum, ba-dum, bum, bum, So he's showing that this 32nd note, this dotted 32nd, is actually going to become very useful and motivic later in the piece. As soon as right here. So he's just deconstructing this right here. Fragmenting. And he writes a ritardando as if just the music just peters out to nothing. Goes up a half step and then just brings much more life into it by writing a tempo and a crescendo. And the reason he does this is, as we heard later, is he's developing an expectation. He's creating an expectation on the listener. But at this point right here, we don't know what to expect. And this is something he borrowed from Haydn. Haydn was a big fan of silences, dramatic silences. He would just stop the music, wait, have some silence, and that silence in the music creates a lot of anticipation and tension. Silence in music is, when used correctly, very powerful. It has probably the most amount of tension in context in terms of tonal music. Is if you leave them on a 5-7, for example, your audience is dying to hear a resolution to a 1 chord, for example. And if you have a silence after a 5-7, then your audience is already anticipating you to resolve it. And if you do, then you fulfilled their expectations. If you don't, then you shock them. So you can play around with this a lot, and this is what Beethoven does. But he doesn't write a fermata, though. He writes ritardando, so it is getting slower, but then he picks it up again and says, aha, here we go, we're coming back, don't worry. This is actually going to become important later, this little scale, this little glissando, I guess you could say, this glissando up to this C right here. This, on the surface, doesn't seem like much, but this will be very important later. And then he goes back into his chorale, and everybody again. Same thing, same. Using the register is very important. Again, his voicing is incredible. And then we have this again. He says, "Up, here we go again." But and now, since we already know what he was going to do, he has this silence. We were expecting, and maybe some resolution, something like that, maybe. He doesn't do that. He slaps us in the face, and this must have been incredibly shocking. It still is. It even startles me sometimes, where I'd be like, oh shoot, is this the second time I'm hearing it, or is it the first time? And then when a good pianist, he just really hits the piano. He comes down hard on this, which I think it needs to be, because he wrote it like this, and the effect is just, you just getting a little heart attack, you getting a little jolt, be like, oh my gosh. So it's a lovely effect, and it's funny. This must have been, I would have loved to have witnessed Beethoven performing this for the first time in front of people and just seeing what their reaction would be. And so here you have the 8th notes, or the 16th notes coming up, and the way this is written, the pattern, this is not an accident. He's going to be reusing this pattern later. Actually, this one exactly. Later, we'll see. But coming back to this, there is actually a little part of the, again, from Rosen, that I'd like to read to you. That actually, again, something that I learned new. Let's see. So he's referring to this crash right here. Measure 34 to 35. He said, while astonishing, this is simply the magnification of a traditional 18th century technique. To establish the E flat dominant from an A flat tonic, it is normal to approach it through a half cadence on B flat, the dominant of the dominant, or 5 of 5. This is absolutely true. This can be made more effectively by a suggestive glance at the dominant of the dominant of the of the dominant of the dominant of the dominant F. So the 5 of 5 of 5. Beethoven opts here for a much more than a glance. He imposes an unprepared fortissimo. He cuts to the heart of the standard technique and displays it enlarged for all to appreciate. This is classical craftsmanship stripped naked, indeed. So normally, if you're trying to go to F right here, go to the 5 of 5 of 5, he's basically saying that you would gradually work your way up to it. You wouldn't just go right to it. So spectacular. So he's keeping this continuing on. So he's keeping up with this 16th note motion that we heard in the bass. Let's get these nice little fireworks going right here. This another fortissimo, this downstroke. And he's keeping everything in thirds and sixths and stuff. So, and now he's bringing back this. Oops, sorry, I forgot to mention that this is transition material. Right here. This is transition material. He's modulating. Let's see. So, and I've been a little partial at this moment because he is bringing back these 32nd notes. I was hesitant to call this theme 2, but he still hasn't grounded himself in any in a key yet. He still hasn't had a cadence only up until here. So this is, I would call it the closing theme, because really it is. So he's just developing this, essentially. He's just essentially developing this 32nd note, which, I mean, at the start of it didn't seem like much, but it has so much character. It seems it's the only, earlier we heard the 32nd note, and now it's coming back again, which is kind of strange. So he's making use of all this, these weird little quirks. He's saying, yes, this is intentional. I'm going to be making use of it. And here we're in E flat, right here. So here is something interesting. This is something that was always puzzling me until I figured out what it was. I was like, bum ba bum ba ba da da ba bum. Like, why does that sound familiar? Ba bum ba bum ba ba da ba bum ba ba da ba ba bum. I'm going to tell you about that afterwards, but before we do, here's something that's really interesting. This little note right here, and it's even in my Henley edition as well. Beethoven cannot carry the preceding motive into the higher octave since his piano had no G or A flat. So, and my edition is printed exactly the same way as well. Now, if I was performing this, I would not blame anybody for playing it, playing the correct register up here, because all this is a copy and paste of this. This is just an octave higher. So it's funny how composers have to make do with limitations of the instrument that they're writing for. So yeah, if you're playing the sonata, yeah, go for it. I mean, sure. Go ahead and reach this high G, or this high A, rather. Yeah, I don't see anything wrong with that. But going back to this little passage, I'm just like, why does this sound familiar? Well, there's a little piece by Haydn called his Trumpet Concerto. He wrote a Trumpet Concerto in 1796. And the last movement sounds very strikingly familiar. So, to this little passage right here. So let me go ahead and play you that passage of the Haydn Trumpet Concerto. Coincidence? I don't think so. It may have been. It was a pretty big piece for Haydn to write, and I think Beethoven may have subconsciously had just stolen it a little bit, and he steals it right here, and it works very well. And even the phrasing is similar. Bum 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 ba 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 bum ba bum ba bum ba 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 bum. So isn't that interesting, huh? So. A little stealing from his former teacher. So I found that very interesting. So, and yeah, fascinating. So moving on a little bit, we go into the development section, and development section is in F major. And she begins the same way. Right here. Bum, 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 bum. Bum, bum, bum. Except he's in now in F major, which is fairly remote, like we mentioned before. But let's go ahead and listen to it. Let's go ahead and listen to it. Section, he's just playing around a little bit. It's not too long, but you can hear what he's doing. He's bringing back the theme in F major, and he's going to be bringing it back in the dominant of F major, which is C major. So nothing is really altered here until this point, really. Then he starts bringing back this little guy again. He uses it as transition material to modulate. This is a monophonic section, which is going to, if I remember correctly, is end. Hold on. Yes. So this will come back in the coda later. But because all it is just octaves essentially. So, but this will end off the movement, as we'll see later. So he's foreshadowing that a little bit. Now we're in C major right here. We've come very far. We've come from four flats to no flats. Pretty far. A flat major to C major. Pretty far away. Not too far, but you know, I mean, he could have gone further, but I mean, this is pretty remote of a key. I mentioned earlier, this little quintuplet becomes more motivic. As we see right here, it becomes a sextuplet and becomes these 1, 2, 3, 4, these 64th notes. And then he starts fragmenting, he starts breaking down. This is deconstruction of the material right here. And he's just playing with it and he's building down. He knows at this point he's trying to build down to, he's trying to come back to the recapitulation. he's building to that very slowly. Here we have this monophonic section again. It's one voice. And this is a little bit of an awkward way to get back to it, but it works. He just chromatically walks back to the recapitulation, which is right here. And same. At this point, he starts varying it up right here. This is something that's reminiscent of Haydn. Haydn varied his music like this a lot of his times. He'd have the middle voice play something akin to this. Let's go ahead and play it actually from here. Let's play it to the end. Straightforward. I think I don't need to touch on anything too much right there. Then so the coda is right here, and you see it's basically just monophonic. It's just one voice in an octave, in octaves, literally until the very end of the piece. So that's how he does it. All right, minuet. Moderato e grazioso. We're going to go pretty quickly through this because I'd like to get on to the finale, and this is taking a long time. But this is, Andras Schiff called this more or less an introduction to the finale. So, what was it called? An intermezzo, I believe, is what he referred to it as. An intermezzo. And it's very lyrical. It's very contrasting. We had something that was very short staccato based. Now we have something that's very legato and lyrical. One voice sings. It's not a chorale. So all these different elements are not only connected somehow, but they are they're contrasting, very contrasting from each other. And it's not slow. It's moderato. So don't play it slow, please. Otherwise, people will fall asleep on you. Let's go ahead and listen to it. I don't think I'll need to slow it down. Oh, shoot. Sorry, I'll need to find the place I'm not supposed to click right there. Alright, so let's find... Where is it? I do apologize. I think it was quarter note equals 108, something like that. Yeah. Thank you. that's a short little piece. Of course, the playback didn't play all the repeats and whatnot, which would have definitely lengthened out this piece considerably. So not much really to talk about, really. It's, I could talk about the phrase structure, I'm not going to, but it's a pretty standard minuet. Things I can point out, though, is notice how he builds. He, again, starts in the middle of the piano. We're going to change colors. Let's do purple. He starts in the middle of the piano, and he's actually rather sparse on voices. He's got a pedal right here, and he's got this little ostinato going on in the tenor voice right here. The alto is picking up the line, the main melody. And you'll notice that the way Beethoven builds is he doesn't have a crescendo in here until this moment right here. And the way he builds is he starts adding more and more voices. So you see here's, for example, one, two, three voice, one, two, three voices. But now until here, he adds this this B flat ostinato, this pedal. And then he goes up to an E flat. This kind of writing is a little clunky, but it's musical. It's definitely musical. And it's sure a hell of a lot better than trying to hold a note like you are right here, because this won't sustain at all. So this is a practical effect. And this also helps keep that momentum driving forward. Bum, 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 bum. So it's just a pedal. But you see there's, you know, we have four voices. Four voice, now we've got one, two, five voices. We got five voices right here. He's reaching down a little bit to grab that E flat right here. But you see, and then once the voices start thinning out, he writes a crescendo. But before that, it starts out very humbly, very subtle. And then it starts to gradually get its strength, more voices start entering in, and then once everybody backs out, then you start, you write a crescendo, and away you go. His phrasing is a little bit interesting. This might be something to note for performances. If I can link the Charles Rosen article that I'm referring to, that I'm keeping tabs on, I would definitely link it in the description. It's a very good read. It's very comprehensive, very to the point. In terms of interpretation, it's interesting to note that Beethoven writes these slurs every bar. He's writing these Mozartian slurs, I guess you could say. Mozart's very common for doing stuff like this, and even Haydn is just some good writing. But then he writes this big, giant slur. And this is signifying a phrase, a cantabile, singing, very vocal, soaring line. And Beethoven will do this a lot in his sonatas, a lot in his music. He writes these unnecessarily long slurs to really show structure, a phrase, or a line, typically. So, and Rosen points out that this is meant to show that it's contrasting from everything else before, that it's the line is supposed to be cantabile and singing and vocal right here. It's supposed to be obviously it's supposed to be connected. So he's got that, and then he's got a very interesting trio section right here, which is just chords. I wouldn't even call it a chorale, but they're contrasting. Very lyrical. Now we have just bits and pieces. Bum bung, bum bum, bum bum, ba dum bum bum, ba da bum. So, yeah, he's nothing too much more to say about this. This is good writing. I mean, making sure that you have this, throwing it up an octave and a register, helps create a more interesting texture. You don't want to be hearing the same thing over and over and over again. Then he modulates back down, da capo. A little coda right here is, it's interesting, it's F flat, na, da, 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 na, ba, ba, this chromatic neighbor tone. I think it's what's called, is it an escape tone? Is that what they're called? Escape tone where you go up a half or up a step and then under it and then resolve it. So you go one above, one below. So found that interesting. And he's just breaking apart this little bum, ba-dum, bum, ba-dum, bum. He's fragmenting the beginning and he's using the parts of the trio section as accompaniment. So I think it's pretty standard. And he writes calando, which means dying away. So you are, this decrescendo is a little bit redundant, but he wants to make absolutely clear that you're getting quieter, because calando means to get slower and softer. This is also the piano is there for, pianissimo. Ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum. So you're dying away. And now the fun begins. The fourth movement, the finale. Marked presto con fuoco. And... oh, no, 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 no. We have to have red. Presto con fuoco means with fire. And this is great. This is a... this is where it gets the name La Chasse in French, or the hunt. Is you have these hunting calls. These, at the time, these would have been hunting calls, so... I don't know how people hunted back then, but I imagine them being on horses with rifles of some kind or something. I don't know. And they'd have a horn. All I know is that the hunting horn, for example, the modern French horn, the way... I don't want to go into too much detail, but in my amazing drawing skills. So a French horn has this shape to it. Because when you're, yeah, you have to be on horseback, you'd have the bugler essentially up at the front, at the head of the pack, essentially leading the charge. And well, if your bell went out in front, then people can't hear what's happening behind you. So that's why the French horn, or the horn, is crooked like it is, so it's facing backwards towards everybody else. Now, why exactly they couldn't just have put the bugler at the back of the pack for everybody to hear in front of him, I don't know. But there you go, a little history lesson for you. So, what was I saying? So, yeah, so he begins presto con fuoco, fast, with fire. And this is an interesting interlocking rhythm he has here. Is it's hard to identify the downbeat at first. And he makes this ostinato very interesting by this D. This D right here. He could have easily have just written another, you know, another one of these groups of E flat major arpeggios, but that would have made a very... very boring and uninteresting accompaniment pattern. So he instead breaks with that, with this D right here, which makes it much more interesting and has a little bit more cohesiveness, I guess you could say, to it. So it makes it more interesting to listen to, more or less. Much more interesting. What else do I have in my notes? Yes, he starts piano, not fortissimo. Sometimes you hear this piece played forte at the beginning because they see presto con fuoco and they say, ah, yes. However, he writes piano. And he writes in the bottom, and this gives him all the room upstairs that he wants to play with up here. And he establishes a ground bass right here. Well, he establishes his foundation with this before he starts building on top of it. So, ba-da-da-da-dum, ba-da-da-da-dum. Starts up high because he wants to build down, and again does the same thing. So he's got these two phrases, this phrase in this phrase. It repeats the same thing twice. Let's go ahead and hear the exposition. And I'm going to have to turn up the tempo a little bit. I don't know how fast. Let's see how fast that is. Okay, there we go. Let's start over. Here is the exposition. Exposition. Very lively. So this is again going to be pretty straightforward to understand, I hope. The only time he gets to forte is right here. This is his first time of forte, and you get a really sense of joy. I get a sense of driving, and yeah, we're going on a I guess a hunting spree, I suppose. But it's a gallop. It's a gallop. You can think of but it's a festive gallop. It's a joyous gallop. And Beethoven is one of those rare composers who's really able to have such, dare I say, bipolar emotions to express in his music. One day he could be writing very tragic, very angry, very sad music, and then the next day he could be writing, you know, Ode to Joy, this piece. I mean, he's so full of life. So let's do that guy. So at this point, we have a B. We don't have theme 2. This is not theme 2. This is still theme 1 right here. All this is theme 1. And he's got this nice little touch right here, this hand crossing with a syncopation. And he writes them very deliberately as quarter notes, not dotted quarter notes. So they're short, like horn calls. Bung, 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 bung. And it's just a minor little detail, but yeah, it helps create the effect that these are short. Almost you can think of him as like brass sforzandos, or maybe even a forte piano, where you get loud at first and then you it dissipates afterwards. I don't know. That's just something I associate with that, and I try to listen to it in that way, as if they're horn calls. And makes sense, right, in this context. Nice writing right here. I approve. Nice contrary motion. Voices going away. Let's see. Where's the next big moment right here? Bump-a-dump-a-dump-a-dump. So he's keeping that rhythm. Here's... theme 2. Apparently, this is not my idea, putting theme 2 right here. This is from, I think this is from Donald Francis Tovey. He says this is where theme 2 is. I'm taking his word on this. And after looking through it more, I can't see where theme 2 would be either. So, I suppose, because it is new material, sort of, even though it's... yeah, I mean, it's new material. Bung, 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 bung. So he's developing. He's gotten this really high point. So he's utilizing the registers again very nicely. And he's nicely building down. And this is actually very nice. This is very nice for the hand right here. Ooh, that's okay. Apart from that, Wow, 4-4, huh? At that tempo. I'm sorry. I'm trying to take a moment, trying to imagine how you would play it like that. 4-3-1. Okay, so that makes sense. See, I don't know, I guess. Yeah. I think what would have been a little bit better is actually for Beethoven. Is actually to have written this as an E octave, in my opinion. I'm sure there's a reason why he didn't do that, because then at least you can reach this with five, and then you extend your hand out very naturally to reach this octave. So it's not a problem at all. But I don't know, there must be some other reason to it that I just don't see. But this is just fragmenting. I mean, it's fragmenting all the time. I don't really have too much in my notes apart from this. He's just fragmenting. There's really not much to do. I mean, there's really not much rhythmic variety. So, but he keeps this very consistent, perpetual motion again. This flowing triplet, pattern. This ostinato. Here's a passage from the first movement. This little arpeggio passage. And this is actually a nice little sequence right here, how he's you can see he's got one notes here, two notes, three, four notes, so he's building up interestingly like that. And I don't think he writes a crescendo. He doesn't write a crescendo, so he creates this effect by simply adding more voices each time. Da-da-da-da-ba-da-da-dum. Here's the closing theme, right here. Okay, what should we choose? Let's do that. Because we're in five, and we're on piano. Bum-ba-dum-ba-dum-ba-dum-ba-dum. This is a fun little passage to play. A little arpeggios right here. Then just a little quotation ending on a 5-7. Bum, bum, ba-dum, ba-dum. And that leads us really nicely back to our one chord. So repeat this, and he actually has the same chord here, and the next few bars are very shocking, harmonically speaking, because he goes to, of all keys, he goes to a flat three, the flat median. Which is weird. It's weird. But it works. It works. And let's go ahead and listen to the development section. Don't press space bar. All right, let's go ahead and listen to the development section. Section. And he went exploring like he usually does, exploring through lots of keys. We see we went to C minor at some point. Where was that? There's C minor right here. Whoops. Not going to focus too much on the development right here because it's pretty obvious, I think. He doesn't have much material to play with anyway. So, I mean, it's not as philosophical as, for example, like the Hammerklavier or any of the late pieces, which I do want to cover at some point. Those are going to be massive lectures, though. So if you think these are long enough, I mean, I'm trying to wrap this up as quickly as I can. I'll still get through everything that I want to say about it. But, yeah, my notes are pretty sparse for this movement as well. Usually the first movements are usually the more important movements, the ones that you can really talk about. But this is a fun piece. I mean, it's a really enjoyable piece, and he's modulating through different key centers and whatnot. So, and the harmonic stuff you can do on your own. I just don't have the energy to try to analyze every single chord and downbeat. That's just not my idea of fun. Important key centers are fun. So here's C minor. So C minor is definitely a fine key to go to, and he sticks around in this. He has a Neapolitan, and he has a 5-7, so and I believe he goes to C major after that somewhere. Let's see, I didn't write it down like I should have. 126 is where he goes to C major. That's not right. Oh, it's 120. Must be 120. Yeah, so here he's in C major right here. Which is, you know, just the relative minor, it's modal interchange, I believe is what it is, because it's not C minor, it's C major. So anyway, so yeah, it's this nice little sequence of building, and he's just does fantastic of building, keeping this motion. And this is where we can start talking a little bit about motor rhythm, sort of, kind of, is just briefly. So motor rhythm, for example, the reason he has a rest here is because this note is taking the place of this downbeat right here. This beat is already occupied. You could have, I don't know, some note, okay? I don't know, just something connecting to here. And the only issue with that is, if you hear it, it has this sense. Let me erase all this. The way it's written currently, it has a sense of motion, this arpeggio. It has that artificial sense that it's moving up. And if you have a note on top of this, it sounds like it's less fluid. It sounds like it's more mechanical. It'll sound chuk-a-da-dun, chuk-a-da-dun, instead of ba-da-da-dum, ba-da-da-dum. I don't know how else to describe it. But I understand why he's doing it. It makes sense. And if you want to create something that's very exciting, that's a good way of doing it, is sometimes putting a rest in every now and then. Helps to separate the lines out a lot more, differentiating them apart. This is nice right here. It's just a little observation. This octave right here, since you're on a one right here, fingering wise, this will be really nice to play because you're already in that current hand position, so good for him. Where is the recapitulation? Recapitulation is 171. So you can analyze all this on your own. I mean, it's not, it's a lot of, he's just modulating, essentially. He's playing around with keys. Not much to say about that. Here we are. Here's recapitulation. Same. Again, not too much to talk about. He's basically just copying and pasting, expected as it should be expected. There's a closing theme right here. He makes it very obvious. This is something that Bach does too, a lot of classical composers. Big cadence right here. And the code is in here somewhere, but the coda is somewhere buried in all this. The coda is morphed into by the preceding closing subject right here, the closing theme right here. So he smuggles it in essentially. Let's go ahead and listen to it. I'm going to actually skip the recapitulation. Just maybe I can, maybe I can't. And just jump right into the coda. Let's see if I can do that. To the end. So the coda is just a continuation, starts with the continuation from the end of the recapitulation. Now he's modulating a little bit and he's just fragmenting. He's just taking this little bit and playing with it. He's elongating it. He's letting it sit. And what this does, alternating it back and forth, is not only is he trying to get back to E flat, but he's creating anticipation, especially with this little section right here, which is actually really fun to play. And then we're back, sort of, kind of, almost. And I think it's also important that he writes pianissimo. Just to really make it ambiguous, because he writes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, because here. Yeah, here's the E. Yeah. Yeah, so now we're back. So now we know what to expect from this point on. Nice hand crossing right here. Really taking advantage of those registers. The ostinato is now in the right hand and is now in the, I would say, like the tenor register, while you have the left hand crossing over with the soprano, and then the bass comes and answers. Little modulation, little borrowing of keys, doing the same thing. So you're having to reach across the hand several times, a lot of hand crossing right here. That gets into a little bit of a frenzy. That is a thick chord right here, and he rolls it. Now, he could have, and yeah. He could have just eliminated this roll altogether. However, that would make it a little bit more difficult to hear all these voices, because you're not accentuating each one of them. You're playing them chunk as a chord. And he also might be doing this just to make it easier to play, perhaps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is all 10 fingers are playing. So, little call and response. This is almost a stretto because it's entering before it has time to finish. So it's, it's a little of a stretto. One last time through here. And then monophonic, much like how the second movement ends in octaves. And that's excellent. Excellent writing right there. So, all right. So that should be Beethoven's 18th piano sonata, Opus 31, number 3, in a nutshell. That was quite a long one. Lots to talk about. It's a very good piece of music. Definitely recommend listening to it on YouTube or somewhere else, listening to a good performance of it. And I hope you got something out of it. I hope this helped you in some way whatsoever, one way or another. Thank you all very much for watching. Do subscribe if you found this useful. And leave a like if this helped you out in any way, and I'll see you guys all later. Thanks so much for watching.